I want to talk with you today about one of those lesser known practices in the beekeeping world, and that's cutting queen cells. So why would someone want to cut queen cells? I have always used queen cell removal as a strategy to mitigate swarming. Again, it doesn't eliminate swarming, but when I layer lots of mitigation strategies together, I reduce that swarming tendency. So during honey production season, colonies have a very strong propensity to swarm. In fact, that propensity starts 2 to 4 weeks before the major nectar flow. I like to go through my colonies every 7 to 10 days and check all of the brood frames for queen cells, and when I see them, remove them. Because think about it, when this colony's ready to swarm, they begin investing in the production of new queens. Once they have a lot of queens being produced in their various queen cells, about half of the population of this colony will leave with the old queen. So that leaves behind all of these developing queens to take over this hive. The first one who comes out might lead another swarm. If she doesn't, she'll go and hunt down her sisters, bite holes in their cells, and sting their developing sisters. So she'll become the reigning matriarch. So that ripe queen cell is kind of that last straw on the camel's back that causes the bees to want to swarm. So if during production season, you couple queen cell removal with something like clipping queens, supering when necessary, equalizing your colonies, you're really attacking a lot of those stimuli that lead to swarming and reducing that swarm tendency. There might be other reasons that you want to remove queen cells. Maybe you have a queen in here and you're outside of honey production season, so you have no need for them to produce a new queen. But typically, as a standard management practice, I always recommend people starting 2 to 4 weeks before their main nectar flow and go through their colony weekly removing those queen cells. Before I cut queen cells, I have to make sure that there's a queen in the nest. They might have queen cells not for the purpose of swarming, but because they're trying to replace a bad queen, or they're trying to replace a queen they don't have. So the first thing I will do when I decide it's swarm cell cutting season, I'll go through, pull a frame or two, and confirm that there are eggs. If I see that there are eggs and the brood pattern looks good, that I feel confident that I could just go through and remove all of the cells. And so how do I do that? Well, what I typically do is I will remove the lid, I will take out the second frame, check it for the queen. If she's not there, I'll set that frame out of the nest, and then I quit looking for the queen. I just need to see the comb. So I'll pull the first frame, shake it, pull it out, make sure there's no cells on it, put it back in its place, remove the third frame, shake it, do that and progress all the way through. Now I keep saying shake it, shake it. Why would I shake a frame of bees? Well, if you leave the bees on the comb, they will cover queen cells. You can't see all the queen cells unless you remove the bees from the comb. So once I get that first frame out, I'm not even looking for the queen from that point forward. I'm just looking for evidence. Are there eggs? Does the brood pattern look good? If so, check, check. Then I'm going straight through to cut queen cells. So let me show you how this process actually works in a hive. So now I'm in the hive. I'm going to follow my standard practice of removing the second frame and look for the queen. If she's not on it, then I'm going to sit that frame out of the nest. It is the last frame that I shake. So I check quickly for the queen. I am not looking for queen cells at this point. I am simply looking for the queen. If I do not see her on this frame, as I note, I will sit it just outside of the nest and I will get back to it. When I removed that first frame, I was able to confirm that it had eggs. The pattern was reasonable. So now it's what I call shake and bake time. I just don't even take the frame out of the nest. I stop right here. Removing that second frame gave me a 2-frame space to work one frame. And I simply shake the bees and I check, no cells, check, no cells, and I return the frame. So really, checking frames for queen cells during swarm season is a relatively quick process. If I were a new beekeeper, I might slowly go through to just confirm. I don't see any on this side. On this one, I see a queen cup that I'm opening. A queen cup is the beginning of a queen cell, so I want to remove those as well. In this context, again, I'm doing this principally for swarm mitigation purposes. I'm shaking all those bees off the frame so I can see these queen cups like what I'm removing and queen cells. It's a really simple process. As you get good with it, you'll be able to go relatively quickly through all of the frames. So here's another queen cup at the bottom here. I've got that removed. Now that I'm in this hive, I see that there's nectar raining out of the combs. That's an indication there's an incoming nectar flow. This hive has a lot of bees. I would definitely consider supering it, because while I'm not finding a lot of queen cells or a lot of queen cups, they will begin wanting to swarm soon just based on their strength and the amount of incoming nectar. Aha! Look here. Queen cup, queen cell. I can tell it's a queen cell because when I squish it, all this royal jelly comes out. There's one there. I don't see any others on the face of this comb. I flip it, and in the same space on the other side, I see a queen cell there and there. Move the bees, don't see them there. And I just keep working my way to the end of the nest. I check every frame in the brood box. And by the way, this is why I really like keeping single deep brood boxes, because I don't like to check multiple boxes for queen cells. It's not necessary to do that. You don't have to cut queen cells. It's just one of those strategies that helps reduce that swarm tendency. Now, I will tell you, commercial beekeepers find this very difficult to do, because obviously it's hard to go through hundreds or thousands of colonies every week just for the purpose of removing queen cells. But for a hobbyist beekeeper, it can be a pretty reasonable strategy to get those cells out and help reduce that swarming tendency. Now I'm at the last frame. It's going to probably be a resource frame. Sure enough, it's full of honey on that side, full of honey and nectar on this side. A little bit of a queen cup there. Now I've got that last frame still remaining outside the nest. I don't even look for the queen. I simply shake it on top and check for queen cells. There is one right here. Got it removed. Flip. Don't see any on this side. And now I've gone through all 10 of the frames, checking for and removing those queen cells. Again, I would not do that if I believed or had reason to believe that this colony was queenless. If it's queenless, then I'm going to leave the two largest cells so that they can try to requeen themselves. But in this case, I knew it was queen right. They're strong. There's evidence that there's incoming nectar, so I want to remove those queen cells. If you do this, you can help alleviate kind of that last thing that pushes colonies out for swarming.